All right. Good evening, everyone. As we're settling in, let's go ahead and open in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you so much for tonight. God, I thank you for each and every individual who has gathered in your house. Father, we've come to praise you. God, we've come to study your word. And God, we've come to worship you. And so, God, we ask that your spirit would just be heavily present, moving amongst us. And God, would you prepare us just for the studying of your word tonight. So, God, we receive these songs of praise. And God, may these songs of adoration also serve as affirmation and encouragement to us in the way that we look to you and trust in you. God, we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
To know the saints of love so amazing, Jesus Messiah, the name above all names, blessed
pray. Father, we thank you once again just for this time. God, I pray that our hearts and our minds would just be attentive to the studying of your word tonight. God, I pray that your spirit would help your word make sense. God, would it find its rightful place in our lives and ultimately our hearts. And God, may we be able to learn just from the mistakes of those who have gone before us. God, we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Good evening, everyone. Welcome on this beautiful Wednesday evening. As many of you are hopefully aware, we have been studying the book of Romans for a few weeks now, maybe about a month if we're trying to be exact. And one of the things we've been emphasizing, and I try to make a point of this as we're early on in our study in the book of Romans, is one of the things that we're trying to emphasize about this particular book of Scripture is that we have to come, or we have to study with this mindset that everything Paul is stating and addressing is in light of the gospel, all right? So as we study the book of Romans, we have to keep what the gospel is all about at the forefront of everything that we're doing. It has to be our lens, it has to be our microscope, it has to be our telescope, it has to be all these different ways for us to better understand just the importance and the power of the cross, okay? And I said it before, and I will continue to say it, that in order for us to appreciate the grace that is shown to us through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, we must, right? We must be confronted with and identify with the bad in our own lives, right? So we can't appreciate the good news without understanding the bad news, right? We can't appreciate the great gift if we don't realize just how undeserving we are of this, okay? And in the book of Romans, the best way that we understand that is being able to identify with our sin. And so the sin that Paul will constantly refer to, the sin that Paul talks about, yes, it is addressed to those people, but it is also addressed to us as people who are recipients of the gospel of Jesus Christ, okay? That's why Paul makes such a conscious effort to communicate all that we have, and that all of us have sinned. We are all guilty of it, and as a result, we are in desperate need of the saving grace of Jesus Christ, okay? And so for the past couple of weeks, we haven't been studying this long, but for the past couple of weeks, we've been looking closely at the wrath of God, trying to understand what that is, how to identify with it, what it looks like, and what it speaks to us, right? What we've taken notice to, the wrath of God, how it's been put displayed for the world to see, and the results of God's wrath, which is what we talked about last week, right? Those who would make the conscious decision to even though they know God, to walk away from God and to choose other things, okay? And so with that said, with all that in mind, tonight we're going to be looking at Romans chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. And so if you are able, let us stand as we read the word of God aloud together. But this is what Paul continues to write to the church in Rome. He says, "Therefore, you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges. For in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself because you, the judge, practice the very same things. We know that the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice such things. Do you suppose, O man, you who judge those who practice such things, and yet you do them yourself, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? But because of your hard and impenitent heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath when God's righteous judgment will be revealed." Amen. This is the word of God for the people of God. Let us be seated. And so tonight, what we're looking at, or the angle that we're trying to understand, is we're seeing the judgment that awaits those who have made the conscious decision to live life a different way, right? That's the direction our scripture has been heading into. And tonight, we will see what it means, at least for us from our perspective, how we might escape God's judgment. Because if we look at tonight's scripture, what we see set up for them is, they are destined for God's judgment. And I would imagine for you and myself, that is not a path, that is not a destiny that we would want to reach, right? Ultimately, we don't want to be met with God's judgment. Instead, we want to be met with God's saving grace. We want to be met with God's mercy. We want to be met with God's grace. And we want to be welcomed into the kingdom of God, into eternity. We don't want to be rejected from it. And so for us, we're gonna identify with their mistakes while identifying it and being able to learn from it. Because I believe the overarching issue when it comes to God's wrath is that this issue is something that is first resolved with the individual more than it is resolved with others. Right? If we're trying to analyze tonight's scripture, the perspective or the thing that we want to reach for is not look beyond ourselves and go, "Oh man, you're the issue. Oh, you're the issue." But instead, we want to look at it from the perspective, okay, well, what they did is they blamed everyone else, when in actuality, there was no accountability for their own actions. And so instead of looking externally, we want to look internally. Right, what we see being addressed in our scripture tonight is an internal issue that is being projected externally onto others. Right, because if you think about it, if you think about the people that maybe you have interacted with, or maybe even for yourself, a lot of times the internal issues that you might have, you project those onto other people. So for example, we live in a society where something like bullying is very affluent, right? And if we've learned anything about people who have bullied others or who are bullying others, it's not necessarily something is wrong with them, but there's something wrong at home. And because there's something wrong at home, what do? They take it out on others. And so if we're looking at that from the perspective of our scripture tonight, well, they're not. It may not necessarily be that they are the issue, but there's something going around in their community, right? There's something going on within their close-knit circle that's being projected onto others. Whether that might be this religious superiority, whether it be this lack of confidence, an overinflated ego, right? The lack of self-confidence. I mean, who knows? We don't know exactly. But what we do know is that the actions that proceed these actions are something that are projected onto other people when they should be dealt with internally. I hope that makes sense. And I believe that there are 4 points that we can see tonight just looking at our 5 scriptures. And Deepak, you want to go ahead and throw that up there for us? Right, the first one is that they are without excuse. Right? If we have 4 points, the first point is they are without excuse. But they make excuses. The second thing is that they judge others. But their judging others leads to their own condemnation. It's not like their judging is helping correct the actions of other people. Instead, because of God's judgment, they will be accountable for their own actions. But one of the problems that we will run into is number 3, is that we will realize that a hardened heart prevents change. A hardened heart will prevent ultimately what God desires most, and that is repentance. And then lastly, an unrepentant heart leads to not life, but to destruction. And those are the 4 things that we will be covering tonight. And I do apologize. My PowerPoint game is not on par tonight. I was not able to fluently prepare all these slides, but I just did enough just to kind of get your attention as we go through these things. But the first thing is this, right? They are without excuse. You see, the first thing we see is that Paul tells us that the people who are subject to God's wrath are without excuse. Like we mentioned earlier, right, this has nothing to do with us acknowledging and coming to terms by understanding. Or I'm sorry, this has to do, and that, right, I read that totally wrong, right? This has to do with us acknowledging and coming to terms by understanding that we are all sinners and we are all guilty of sin. Right? One of the things that Paul has been adamant about communicating is that the people that he is referring to and the people that he is addressing are without excuse. There's no way for them to justify their actions. And the reason why they are without excuse is because, as we learned last week and the week before, is that they know who they are. They know who God is. They know what God desires. They even know what God requires. They even know that God sent his one and only son to die on a cross for their sins. And yet, they choose differently. You see, when Paul says that they are without excuse, he means that their actions and the decisions that follow are inexcusable. Right? They will not be able to defend themselves, and they will not be able to justify their actions. And actually, the Greek word used to describe the phrase without excuse is the same word that Paul uses to describe that they are without excuse because God has made himself known through creation. And so in other words, the argument that Paul is making, or the way that Paul is trying to capture their attention, he's saying that God has done everything necessary to reveal himself. You have acknowledged that revelation, and yet these people are choosing to live otherwise. But you know, I think the great issue that we have to understand in these people and them being without excuse is that the solution has also been made to known to them. Does it make sense? So not only do they know what God requires, but they know the solution that has been made known to them. And what I mean by that is, even though they're without excuse when it comes to knowing God, at the same time, they are without excuse because God has also made visible and tangible his very solution to their problem. And yet, even still, they have chosen to do otherwise. They have chosen to live their lives otherwise. And they have chosen to give their devotion and their worship to other things. And as a result, the issue runs much deeper in their lives and in their actions. Which brings us to the second point, in that judging others will lead to our own condemnation. So more than just God revealing himself, right? More than God just revealing his son, Jesus Christ, and revealing his wrath of the cross upon his very own son, another issue we find with these people, or another issue that we find these people struggling with, is their passing of judgment on others as if they are guiltless and blameless. In other words, they hear the warnings, and God, that's not for me, that's for you. Right? God's word should be convicting them, but yet they deflect and say, no, that's not me. God's not talking to me. God is talking to you. Right? Which I believe would be the polar opposite of us, because we love a good sermon that speaks to us. We love a good sermon as if God is speaking to us directly. And that is great for you. But for these people, it's complete opposite. Everything that would be said on behalf of anything that would be said that would deserve a change or conviction, they would never think of themselves. They would think of other people. You see, the phrase passage judgment comes from the Greek word krino, and it primarily signifies to distinguish, to separate, or even to discriminate, and then to distinguish between good and evil, right and wrong, without necessarily passing an adverse sentence, though it is usually involved. And one thing to note about krino is the present tense of the word, and that would indicate to us that they were actively passing judgment, right? This wasn't an issue that they had done before and had gone unresolved. But what Paul is addressing is a continuing, constant issue. They were continuing to pass judgment. It was an ongoing thing. And one thing that Paul is trying to establish by addressing the issue is that by passing judgment, or by continuing to pass judgment, by implication means condemning. In other words, they were judging not as a means to help people. They weren't judging as a means to help resolve an issue. They weren't judging as a means that someone would change their ways. But they were judging in ways like, you, sinner. You're terrible. You're bad. You're no good. You're hopeless. Right? Which is totally against what the gospel is all about. Right? There's a theologian, his name is William Lewis, and he writes that the word krino meant originally to separate, then to distinguish, to pick out, to be of opinion, and finally to judge. The act of judgment was therefore that of forming an accurate and honest opinion of someone, thus appraising his character and placing him in a certain position with respect to the law of God. And the result of such a judgment is commonly condemnation. But the greater issue of them judging is their demeanor communicated that they were exempt from judgment. And that is a greater issue. When you, once again, judge others and then think of yourself as blameless. You are guilty. I'm innocent. And so I think one of the greater tangible analogies that can help us better grasp this concept is that I want you to imagine for a moment that you're driving on I-5. And I know some of you have a heavier foot than others, right? The speed limit is a suggested, right, number. But let's imagine that we're all driving on I-5. And for whatever reasons, the speed limit is 65, yet you decided to go 85. And then everyone else around you is maybe going around 80 to 85 as well. But you get pulled over. And more than likely, what is going to be your response to the Washington State Patrol trooper? Why are you pulling me over? You see everyone else? They were speeding. They were going just as fast, if not faster. Or you might say something along the lines of, like, don't you have something better to do? Maybe don't you have to go, like, find somebody who's driving recklessly? Right? This was the heart. This was the demeanor of those that Paul was referring to. Even though they were guilty, even though it was blatant that they were wrong, even though it was blatant that they were sinful beings that lacked repentance, they deflected and said, well, there has to be somebody worse than me. Why don't you go pick on him? Why don't you go judge him? You see, the latter part of verse 1 tells us, for in passing judgment on one another or on another, you condemn yourself because why you, the judge, practice the very same things. Right? Can you see what the picture that Paul is painting for us? You see, Jesus actually addresses a similar issue when it comes to those who were supposed to uphold the law, who were supposed to be these religious examples for the book of the law. Right? In Matthew chapter 7, Jesus talks about the judging of others, right? He tells us, you know, don't judge because you too will be judged, right? If you judge, you're going to bring judgment upon yourself. And that's right, and it's fitting that this is a problem then and even here because these people didn't choose Jesus. Right? They chose other things. But in the conversation of judging others, Jesus essentially will go on to say, why are you so worried about the speck of dust in someone else's eye when there is a 2x4 sticking out of yours? Right? We see what happens when we don't look internally, but when we look externally. But we see what happens when we don't think that this is meant for us and we deflect and think that it's for somebody else. This is what happens not only to our mentality, but our heart when we think that Scripture isn't speaking to me or isn't identifying with me, especially when it comes to the more negative things of our lives. And we say, oh, no, that's for somebody else. But Paul says, or Paul reassures us that you're guilty of the very things you are trying to judge others for. And once again, the very thing they are guilty of is described using the present tense of the verb, indicating what? That this was an ongoing problem that wasn't going to stop anytime soon. You see, the greater warning we need to pay attention to when it comes to this type of hypocritical actions or lifestyle, or just depending on how you want to describe it, is that it comes with our own judgment. Right? Our own hypocrisy will bring about our own judgment. And that is something that we need to be very, very careful of. Verse 2 will tell us that we know that the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice such things. And Paul's first point about the judgment of God is not based on incomplete or inaccurate or circumstantial evidence. Rather, it is based on the truth, the whole truth, and what? Nothing but the truth. He does not have one standard for the Jews and another for the Gentiles. Those who live or practice such judgment will be judged equally under the wrath of God. The third thing is this. And I think this is more for us, and it speaks more for us and our current situations, is that a hardened heart prevents repentance. A heart that is hardened, a heart that has gone stale, prevents repentance. In verse 4, Paul writes, or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to what? To repentance. And the Greek word for presume is kataphroneo, right? Kataphroneo. And it means to think lightly, right? To think lightly. It literally means to think down upon or even to despise, scorn, or hold in contempt. It means to not care for because it is thought to be without value or, right, the projected value is less than in your own opinion. You see, the idea of kataphroneo is to look down on someone or something with contempt or aversion, with the implication that one considers the object of little value or as unworthy of your notice or even your consideration. Think about what it's referring to when it comes to God's what grace, forbearance, and so forth. You see, interestingly, I know that the definition of kataphroneo and the usage of it seems very negative, and it is, right? In the New Testament, or I'm sorry, in the Greek translation of Scripture, this word, the specific word in its in the way that it's used 11 times, right, in the Word of God. But one of those times is actually Jesus uses to describe, right? And I found this interesting, but Jesus uses the phrase kataphroneo when he thought little of the shame the cross would bring on him. So the shame that was meant to be displayed in the cross, meaning the humiliation, Jesus thought lightly of it. In other words, it wasn't something that would deter him. It wasn't something that would affect his decision or his allegiance or his willingness to fulfill the Father's plan. I thought that was interesting. But then we see in the book of Proverbs that King Solomon uses it for the opposite end of an example. And he uses it to describe a person who is careless with the ways of God and how that will lead to death. Right, so we see Jesus give us an example of what it means to think lightly of what the world thinks. And then the other side, King Solomon gives us an example of what will happen to an individual, what happens to a person's life when they think lightly of what God desires and requires from the individual. You see, ultimately what we have to understand about kataphroneo is that the projected value or worth is thought less of than what is intended. And that is the effect of a hardened heart. We see that the people who know God, who are supposed to be without excuse, have chosen life away from God. And as a result, they think lightly of the richness of God's kindness, forbearance, and patience. You see, when it comes to God's kindness, or when it came to God's kindness, guess what? There was an abundance of God's kindness. Yet, they took it lightly. Charles Spurgeon says that God's goodness or God's kindness may refer to the way in which he has overlooked all of our past sins so that he has not yet dealt with us in justice concerning them. Isn't God good? This is God's kindness, meaning that as there is an abundance of it, there is enough of it to forget or to hold off on the judgment that is owed to us for the things that have occurred in the past. And then when it came to God's forbearance, right? And Spurgeon says that his forbearance may refer to what? Our present sins. And guess what? God's forbearance, there was an abundance of that as well. And yet, they took it lightly. Then there's God's patience. Right? And God's patience might refer to our future sins. And so not only is our past taken care of, not only is our present taken care of, but the things that might happen in the future, the things that are to come, those are also taken care of. Because lo and behold, I would imagine that some of us in this room might succumb to sin tonight or maybe tomorrow. And yet God's patience, as it is an abundance of, covers that. And yet for these people, guess what they did? They kataphroneoed. They took it lightly. Why? Why? You see, Spurgeon says this in light of the heart and attitude of those addressed in this verse by saying, sin is always on the downward grade, so that when a man proceeds a certain length, he inevitably goes beyond it. The person addressed by the apostle first thought to escape judgment. Then he came to think lightly of the goodness, the forbearance, and long-suffering of God, aka patience. He thinks he shall escape in the future, and because of that, he despises the present goodness and long-suffering of the Most High. Of course, he does. If he does not believe in the terrors of the world to come for himself, he naturally reckons it to be a small thing to have been spared their immediate experience. Barren tree as he is, he does not believe that he will ever be cut down. and therefore he feels no gratitude to the dresser of the vineyard for pleading. In other words, he says, that ain't for me. That ain't going to happen to me. I'm going to be okay. Right? This is the fruit of a hardened heart. And then in the first part of verse 5, Paul said this is the result of a heart that is hard and impenitent. You see, a heart that is hardened is stubborn and sees no need to repent. But what Paul says is that the kindness of God is meant to what? Lead us into repentance. Right? The goodness of God calls you and I to what? To repentance. And the thing that you and I need to understand as we are learning from these people's mistakes is that the goodness of God, the forbearance of God, and the patience of God is inviting, not rejecting. God's kindness should gravitate us toward him, not away from him. But a hardened heart fails to see that. A hardened heart fails to see the invitation. A hardened heart fails to see that the door is flung wide open. But God's goodness, God's greatness, God's mercy, his love is continually inviting us to what? To return to him. Right? As we know, repentance at its core is a change of mind that results in action. And so if a sinner honestly changes his or her mind about sin, then he or she will return to the Lord. In other words, they will turn away from that sin, and the only way to go is where? Toward God. Once again, let's look at Spurgeon, right, who has a lot to say on this topic. Let's look at what he says about repentance. He describes it like this. He says, a man may hate sin just as a murderer hates the gallows, but this does not prove repentance. If I hate sin because of the punishment, I have not repented of sin. Right? We're just scared. I merely regret that God is just. But if I can see sin as an offense against Christ or Jesus Christ and loathe myself because I have wounded him, then I have a true brokenness of heart, which leads us to what? To repentance. He goes on to say this. I don't believe it's up there. But he says, to hate sin because it has caused the brow of Christ to be girt with the thorn crown, and the face of Christ to be dishonored with a spittle, and the hands of Christ to be pierced with the nail. This is repentance. Not because I am afraid of hell, not because sin brings pain and penalties with it, but because it made Jesus Christ to suffer for me such pangs unutterable. Repentance and faith are like Siamese twins. If one is sick, the other one cannot be well, for they live but one life. And for us, the takeaway is that repentance is not only necessary, it is vital to the well-being of our faith, which translates into the well-being of our relationship with Jesus Christ. And so lastly, we'll close with point number 4, and that is this: an unrepentant heart leads to destruction. Right? An unrepentant heart does not lead to life. It does not lead us on a path that will lead us into eternity. But an unrepentant heart fails to see the trail that has been already established by Jesus Christ and thinks that there is a different path. You see, in verses 3 and in verses 5, Paul describes what is happening as a result of their actions. In verse 3, he says, do you suppose, O man, you who judge those who practice such things and yet do them for yourself, that you will escape the judgment of God? And then in verse 5, he says, but because of your hard and impenitent heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. As we said it before, and we'll say it again, when there is no repentance, we will be met with judgment. When there is no repentance, we will be met with a judgment that will lead to destruction. And the thing that we have to understand that is there is no escaping the judgment of God without repentance. Right? When there is repentance, you will dodge a bullet. But when there is no repentance, it will ultimately lead to death. You see, the judgment of God cannot be ignored. It won't magically go away. Just because you close your eyes and say, oh, it's not real, it's not real, doesn't mean that it's not going to be real. But if one thing is certain, if Scripture tells us that one thing is certain, and that is the judgment of God will be revealed. And those to whom it is owed will be on the receiving end of that judgment. But the key to escaping God's judgment and wrath is a heart that repents and returns to Him. And so how can we repent when our hearts are hardened? How can we repent when our hearts have grown stale? How can we repent when our hearts have become callous? Scripture doesn't really give us this answer. But I believe it's already there, present for us, if we look hard enough. And that is what? Remember God's kindness. Right? Remember His grace. And remember His mercy. Because that scripture says, God's kindness is meant to lead us to what? Into repentance. Right? There is an abundance of it. And there is enough of it to soften the hardest of hearts. But we have to remember that we will not be met with judgment when we decide to make that turn and to return to Him. And so we'll stop it there tonight. Next week, we'll pick up things with verse 6, and we will make our way forward. And so with that said, let us stand, and we'll close in prayer tonight, and we'll be on our way. Father, we thank You so much for tonight. Father, we just thank You for your kindness. God, we thank You that You are so patient with us. God, we know that we are not anywhere near being perfect, and yet even still Your grace is extended to us. God, You continually show us mercy. And Father, I pray for anyone in this room whose heart might be even just the slightest of stiffness. God, I pray for anyone in this room whose heart might be becoming harder than we would imagine. God, I pray that by the conviction of Your Holy Spirit that You would help us to realize the hardness that is being created, and that God, we would remember your kindness, because that is the very thing that will lead us into repentance. Father, I thank You that You continually forgive us. Father, I pray that we would not be a people who looks around and judges others, but God, when we are met with Your scripture, when we are met with Your word, God, when we are met with conviction, God, may we first see how that evaluates us, and how that convicts us, and how that is calling for us to change in our own lives before we would even begin to look externally. God, we thank You so much. And now we just ask that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and that the everlasting love and the kindness of God the Father, and may the power, may the wisdom, may the anointing of the Holy Spirit truly be with us all until we meet in Your house once again. Amen and amen. Thank You, church. May you go in peace.